your seat as we proceed. I want you to know God is doing something, and God is stirring something on the inside of you. Are you hearing me? Yesterday we started by talking about intimacy, and Pastor Courtney was talking about the importance of intimacy. You see, this last move of God is not just going to be about signs and wonders. Do you understand? God never asked us to seek his hands. You see, when you seek signs and wonders, like seeking his hand. Do you understand? Hallelujah. The Bible says, called him El Shaddai, meaning the multi-breasted one. You know, yes. God never asks us to seek his breasts. Do you understand? You're not supposed to seek his supply. Amen? God never asked us to seek even his shoulders. You know what shoulders talks about? His government. Because some people always want position and authority. They always seek that, like Lucifer. One thing he asked, he didn't even ask us to seek his feet. You know, the feet talk about the move of God. Because some Christians are all about the move of God. You know, let there be revival, and then they end up stuck in the upper room. Amen. What did he ask us to seek? His face. Hallelujah. You know, I was just studying, and I'll just share that, and then I'll call up Jake to come and share. One of the stories of David. David had about three sons. He had more than three sons. The first son was Amnon. The second son was Caleb or something like that. The third one was Absalom. The fourth one was Adonijah. And so Amnon was the firstborn, and he wanted to, you know, have a relationship with his stepsister, who was the sister to Absalom. And so he did everything to get that, and he wasn't able. So he went, and one of his friends advised him how to get to her. And the long story short, he raped her and kicked her out of his house. And her brother, who was Absalom, was very mad, but he didn't say anything. For 3 years, he kept quiet. And after 3 years, he took permission from David and said, let all your sons come to my house and have a party. And so David probably forgot what had happened. His son had passed away. I mean, you know, all that had gone away. So he released his children to go. And then Absalom killed Amnon, who was the firstborn. And after killing Amnon, he fled from Israel and fled to his mother's place, which was in Geshur. And the Bible says he stayed there for about 3 years. And after 3 years, David's heart began to long for Absalom. I'm trying to give you a picture of reconciliation. His heart began to long for Absalom. And so when Joab, David's captains, realized it, he went and got a wise old lady and tried to, you know, get the king to get Absalom come back. And so when the king realized it, he said, okay, let Absalom come back. But he said something, let him not see my face. So Absalom came back to Israel, or came back to Jerusalem, but he went to his house. He did not see the face of David. And after 2 years of not seeing the face of David, he said, why did the king call me if I don't see his face? I'm trying to tell you that without contact with the face, reconciliation is not complete. And that's what we were talking about yesterday. That Jesus Christ didn't just come to give us, you know, a hotline to call to God, to talk to God. He came to bring us into the face of God. And then finally, David allows and gives Absalom permission, and Absalom comes into the presence of David. That's what we call reconciliation. And David kisses him. Amen? But there was a problem with Absalom. Remember what I said, if your heart is not right, you can't get around the throne of the Father. Absalom did not love the father, his father. He wanted his throne. And I'll stop there. But one thing about Absalom, the Bible tells us that he was perfect in beauty. He's the second person the Bible mentions perfect in beauty. The first person was Lucifer. The second person is Absalom. The Bible says no flaw in his body. And he went after his father's throne. Amen. And that was what destroyed him. Amen. But I'm just trying to talk about reconciliation. It's all about getting back into the face of the Father. Hallelujah. It's not enough now just to go to church, you know, and warm the chairs. It's time to meet with God. You know, I study all the scriptures, and all these people had encounters that changed their lives and changed their generations. In our time, we just want to go to church and sit for 30 minutes in the service and think we can change the world. No. That's why the devil is doing extra work in the world today and in the churches and even in our homes. But But I believe the time has come. There's a generation that will seek. It says, this is the generation that will seek thy face, O God of Jacob. How many of us are in that generation? Many of you are still looking at me. Okay. Hallelujah. Without wasting time, I'm going to call up our evangelist. Amen. He is in the process. God is preparing him for greater things. Amen. Hallelujah. And I believe God is going to use him tonight to minister to you. And then after that, Minister Sydney will come up. Amen. Let's put our hands together as Jake takes the stage. Amen.
So El Shaddai, how do I follow that? The multi-breasted one. So Ashley, she touched on something just a few minutes ago when they were singing the Break Every Chain song. The fact that Paul, at one point in prison, had his chains broken, that is one of my favorite stories in all the Bible. It's in Acts 16. So Acts 16 teaches us something really, really powerful. And it is what we should be doing, something that Paul did, something that Silas did. Because before those chains were broken, before they even got into prison, they were out and about. They were preaching the gospel. And the gospel was what they did, but unfortunately that was pretty much illegal. And because they were preaching the gospel, because they were doing what they were supposed to do, because they were doing what Jesus had sent them out in the world to do, they were beaten, thrown into the innermost part of the prison. And even then, at midnight, what were they doing before those chains broke? They were in stocks. They were singing and they were praying. Not only were they singing and praying, but everyone around them heard them. They were witnessing. Beaten, in pain, in the dankest, most dark part of the prison, that is where they were doing the work of God. As those chains were broken, they still weren't done. Not only did the prisoners hear them, but the jailer himself and his entire household that was watching over them got saved. So when you're talking about chains breaking, these just aren't your chains. This is an opportunity. Right now, we are living in what you could consider the greatest time ever to actually evangelize, to witness, to do what Paul and Silas couldn't have ever dreamed of doing. They could not reach the entire world. But we, with the click of a button, can pretty much affect the entire face of this earth. So that's something I want to encourage you. So when those chains come off, you got to know, you got a job to do. And that job is to preach the gospel. All right. So tonight, I want to talk about something that is very important. And that is love. God gives us two basic commandments. When they ask Jesus, what are we supposed to do? Love God, love one another. Now, love is something that is thrown around. It is a word that is used and abused, and that's something that probably everyone in this room, including myself, is guilty of. I can say, I love my family, I love my wife, I love my children, I love raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens. Love is a word that is thrown around a lot. So most of us in here, professing Christians, we know what it is to love God. That's what we do. It's inherent to accepting Christ as your Savior, is the love of God. So that's the first commandment. But what does it mean specifically to love one another? Loving one another is something that doesn't really come inherently to us as humans because, well, we're selfish. And selfishness is the exact opposite of love. So I'm going to read out of Romans 12, starting at verse 9 and ending with 21. Let love be without hypocrisy. Detest evil. Cling to what is good. Love one another deeply as brothers and sisters. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lack diligence and zeal. Be fervent in the spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in affliction. Be persistent in prayer. Share with the saints in their needs. Pursue hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud. Instead, associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Do not repay evil, or do not repay anyone evil for evil. Give careful thought to do what is honorable in everyone's eyes. If possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Friends, do not avenge yourselves. Instead, leave room for God's wrath, because it is written, "Vengeance belongs to me. I will repay," says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For in so doing, you will be heaping fiery coals on his head. Do not be conquered by evil, but conquer evil with good. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We ask that you help us to learn to love one another exactly how you have written for us to love one another. Lord God, we know that in this Holy Spirit conference, that having the empowerment of the Holy Spirit brings us to a place where love is inherently more easy. Lord Jesus, we ask that anyone in this room that is unprepared to either love God or love their brother, that you impress upon them the importance of obeying and following these two commandments that you've given us. Lord Jesus, we ask that the text I'm going over today seeps into the hearts of everyone. Amen. So first off, in verse 9, let love be without hypocrisy. Avoid hypocrisy. So we want to be sincere and genuine. Now, sincerity is an interesting word. So if you go back to the Greek root word, yes, I'm going to reference some Greek words. Actually, I'm not. They're very difficult to say, and honestly, I'm not that smart. However, the root word in Greek talks about basically in the marketplace, in the marketplace of the Greek culture back in Jesus' day, they would have a process, and that was a process of the artist creating sculptures. And the sincerity comes from basically this wax that they would use. And this wax is something that when they would create this marble sculpture, you really had one chance to get it right. So if you created the face of someone and you knocked off their nose, what they could do is go and get some of this sincerity wax and stick it back together. And what would happen is it looked fine and it looked fantastic. But when the heat would actually come down and melt that wax, then you would have something that was completely, well, not what you originally paid for without you even knowing it. So sincerity means this is legit. This is the full thing. There's no wax holding this thing together. When I'm being sincere to you, I am giving you absolutely everything. There is no cause for you to think that I am being anything less than genuine. So avoid hypocrisy. So if you also go to verse 10. So verse 10 is going to say, love one another deeply as brothers and sisters. Outdo one another in showing honor. So loving as a brother and sister. Brothers are family. Family. So what does that lead us to? Family, community. And to have community, which means you basically have to fellowship. Brothers live under the same roof. Community is joined together constantly. This takes us right back to something we hammer on pretty often here at Lakeside, and that is the Acts 2 fellowship. Without the fellowship, how can we be brothers and sisters? How can we love one another as a family? How can we love one another as a community? If we come in on Sundays, shake each other's hands and say, hey, how you doing, brother? Because you can't remember someone's name? Do you really love them like a brother? Do you really love them like a sister? Being able to know someone's name, being able to know their personality, know their wants and know their needs, that is part of brotherly and sisterly love. And that's something that we should strive to achieve. So moving on, still staying in verse 10 there. Give preference to others. Honor the desires of others before your own. Now again, that comes back to our selfish nature. We are inherently give me, give me, give me. Yet Christ teaches us to give to others. We saw that he was a servant. I mean, he served those around him. Not only was he preaching and teaching the way to heaven, but he was literally feeding people. He knew that when people followed him out into the wilderness, that they would not be able to survive a trip back. They'd pass out, they'd fall down, they'd probably die without food. So he took it upon himself to actually make sure that their physical needs were met. He fed them. My fourth point, if we go over to verse 13, share with the saints in their needs. Pursue hospitality. Be hospitable. Look for ways to meet the needs of others. Again, going back to where Jesus fed the multitudes. He met their physical needs. Next point, point five, going over verse 14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. So this is going to be returning good for evil. Boy, is that difficult. Someone does you wrong. What you going to do? What you going to do? Act. Don't react. When others hurt you, it's not your job. It's not your job to get back. Your job is to love them. When someone goes out of their way or just does something to you that grinds against your nerves, it is your job to, one, either let it go, pray about it, or you know what? Let God do what God does. So my sixth point, verse 15. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. This is identifying with others. Treat others' needs or victories as your own. Part of the community, when someone has something good happen to them, jealousy is not what we're looking for here. What we're looking for is love. When one of your friends has something fantastic, something good happened in their lives, we need to ensure to build them up. This is a key in being a good friend. Don't let jealousy creep into your heart, but make sure that when someone has a victory, you also share in that victory. And you know what? Vice versa will come back to you. So moving on to 16, live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud. Instead, associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Be open-minded towards others. Seek to connect with anyone you speak to. So this is part of the Great Commission. When you are out and about, and just as part of your random any day, going to Walmart, going to the store, being at work, whatever you do, you need to be a positive influence. So when you are seeking to connect with anyone, this is very, very important that we be the person that can reach out to them. Say, hey, I'm Jake. You want to be friends? You don't want to be friends? Well, that's fine. I hope you have a fantastic day. Not every connection is going to be a positive one. However, you're not going to make any connections with a sour look on your face or when you're looking down at the ground or when you're just being grumpy. Because when you're grumpy, pretty much all your connections are going to be terrible. And no one will like you. I'll like you. Maybe not, but I will love you because the Bible tells me to. All right, verse 17. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Give careful thought to what is honorable in everyone's eyes. So we want to treat everyone with respect. This is a compliment to any person. So when you respect someone, they will inherently want to give respect back to you. And dealing with an environment like we have here in Elizabethtown, this is a multicultural environment. Whereas I really personally don't care if you show me certain types of respect. Other peoples from other cultures and other groups rely on a community that is based on respect. So respect that is given is generally received back, and that is important. Just moving on to verse 18. If possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Now, this is difficult, because no matter how much you love them, there's going to be a lot of people that you just really don't like. And that's because they've got personalities that go against the way that your personality is. And that is fine, and that's okay. You can still love them, and you can still be friendly with them, even if they are not the type of personality that you want to be with. However, you need to do everything possible to keep the peace. You can't always make peace with absolutely everyone, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't try. Choose wisely which hills to die on. When you draw a line in the sand, make sure that you are doing it for something that is really important. Because when you say to someone, this is the way it is and I'm not ever going to change, you've not made peace with them. You've probably not made friends with them. And it's going to be very difficult for you to show them Christ-like love past that point. So moving on to the end of the chapter, verse 19 and 20. Friends, do not avenge yourselves. Instead, leave room for God's wrath, because it is written, vengeance belongs to me. I will repay, says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For in doing so, you will be heaping fiery coals on his head. Remove revenge from your life. Because as I mentioned earlier, it's not your job to seek revenge. It's God's job. He will take care of you. He is the good shepherd. We are the sheep. We are supposed to fall in line at this point. So if you have revenge in mind or in your heart, just know that God is a just God. And at some point, maybe not in this life, justice will be served. So as we see here, a lot of these things are inherently against the human selfish nature. But what we do know is this, that when Acts rolls around, we had a band of 12 people, pretty much all of which had sworn allegiance to a man that they called Jesus. They swore allegiance to him. They lived with him. They loved him. He taught them. He fed them. They were brothers. And yet, when it was his time to do the most important task, the one thing that he was sent here to do on earth, they left him. When he came back, he gave them a specific instruction. After he rose from the dead, his instruction was, wait here, tarry in Jerusalem. And they did. And within the turn of a few pages, these men that either denied him or left him to die pretty much alone were boldly empowered to preach the gospel to the nations. And that was through the indwelling and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So when you're talking out of your belly, rivers of flowing water will flow. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is exactly what you need. To love like this, my argument today is you're not going to be able to achieve this level of love in the way that you need to without the Holy Spirit's empowerment. It is that important. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We're going to prepare our hearts for the main message this evening. Hallelujah. Minister Sydney has been part of this assembly for, what, almost 2 years now? Amen. God, 3, okay. And God has been using him to bless us in these programs. And I've tried to not be the only person speaking. I've tried to, you know, let other people speak also. And also some of the students or the current graduates from the school also, we've been trying to feature them to prepare them. Because I believe in the years down, they will be handling some of these programs. Amen? Amen. So if you have not been asked to speak, maybe you need to get ready. Amen? Some of you know who I'm talking about. Amen? Hallelujah. Emma. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together for the Lord as Minister Sydney brings the word. Amen.
Thank you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. God, we thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. And I really appreciate Dr. Norm, his, the conferences. And I think every conference just gets better and better. And Tim, I think the last conference was when you laid, am I correct? When you laid your cane? Was it the last conference or the conference before that? It was the last. But anyway, it's still there. And our brother was up here tonight with the flags, praising God. Those chains were falling. God is moving in Lakeside. God is moving. Hallelujah. And I, like I said, I appreciate Dr. Norm and kind of orchestrating the plan. Jake talked about briefly the enabling of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to talk about plugging in to the Spirit of God. So, and again, you know, he called it orchestrated. You got both ball guys to speak tonight. So great orchestration, Doc, and we appreciate you. We love you. Praise God. So, you know, some of you know, I like to start off with some humor before I speak, kind of like break the ice. And so this is biblical because in Job, it talks about the sons of God going before God, and also talks about the devil, Satan, going before God, right? I mean, so it says Jesus and Satan were having an ongoing argument about who was better at the computer. They had been going at this for days, and God was tired of hearing all the bickering. Finally, God said, "Cool it. I'm going to set a test that will run for 2 hours, and I will judge who does the better job." So Satan and Jesus sat down with the keyboards and typed away. They moused, they did spreadsheets, they wrote reports, they sent faxes, they sent emails, they sent out emails with attachments, they downloaded, they did genealogy reports, they made cards, they did everything known and every known job. But 10 minutes before their time was up, lightning suddenly flashed across the sky, thunder rolled, rain poured. And as expected, what do you think happened? The lights went out. The electricity went off, obviously. Satan stared at his blank screen and screamed every, you know, profanity that he probably can think of under the world. Jesus just sighed. The electricity finally came on and flickered back on, and each of them restarted their computers. Satan started searching frantically, screaming, "It's gone, it's all gone. I lost everything," when the lights went out. Meanwhile, Jesus quietly started printing out all of his files from the past 2 hours. Satan observed this and became irate. "Wait, he cheated. How did he do it?" God shrugged his shoulder, and with a smile on his face, he said, "Jesus saves." So tonight, at the conclusion of my sermon, if you're not saved, we're going to give you opportunity to experience the salvation of Jesus tonight. And this is a Holy Ghost conference. We're also going to pray that you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit if you have not experienced that. So we're here tonight to really change your lives. So I'm going to talk about the early church. And my text is taken from Acts chapter 4, verses 31 to 33. I don't know which translation he's going to use, but I'm going to read from my notes. If you can follow along with me, may not match. But verse 31 through 33 of Acts chapter 4 says, "And they prayed. The place where they were meeting was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spake with the word of God, spoke the word of God boldly. All the believers were in one heart and one mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions were their own. They all shared what they had. With great power," verse 33, "with great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all." And we've talked about it several times. Pastors talked about it. Dr. Norman's talked about it. And we talk about the presence of God filling the place, filling the house before it filled the apostles. It said it filled the place. The place shook. They were experiencing the power of God. You know, and today I believe that we can experience the same power that the apostles experienced in those days. It's still available for us today. God is not dead. He is alive. The same God that they served over 2,000 years ago is our God today. He's the same God. The word of God says he never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Verse 31 again, it says, "And they, as they prayed," and the Bible tells us to pray. We're going to talk about 3 points. One of them is prayer. But the Bible talks about praying. Jesus said, "When you pray." He didn't say, "If you pray." He said, "When you pray." That means he's telling us we need to pray. When you pray. So when they prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And they spoke the word of God with boldness. The Holy Spirit gives you boldness. You know, part of my testimony is before I became filled with the Holy Spirit, I wasn't very bold. I mean, I had other attributes that weren't very conducive to being a Christian, but I wasn't bold. I didn't spread the word of God. But after being filled with the Holy Spirit, it changed my life. It transformed my life. And I was supposed to pick up my wife, but she can attest to it. It changes your life. So plugging into God's presence, plugging into the power of God. Some of the things that the apostles did, and this is after the power of God came upon them. One day, 5,000 were saved. 5,000. One day, 3,000 were saved. And the Bible says, and it added to the church. The church was added to daily. Because of the ministry of the apostles and the power of God in their lives, the church was added to daily. You know, in some ways, we have more of an advantage than the apostles did. And Jake talked a little bit about those advantages. The internet. They didn't have iPhones. They didn't have iPads. They didn't have iCloud. To save stuff and to do research and to like you know, or make notes from the computer or other messages. They didn't have that. They had to rely solely on the power of God in their lives. And we need to do the same thing. We need to rely on the power of God, not rely on our phones, not rely on our jobs, rely on the power of God in our lives. So the early church had three sources, specific sources. I'm going to talk about those in a few minutes. So I want to reference this lamp that you wonder, why did he bring a lamp up? We're talking about plugging into the power of God. So, yeah, that's a pretty, you know, nice looking lamp, right? I mean, we call it an accent lamp. And it's kind of like accents your room and or your desk. But if this is a pretty good looking lamp. But it just sits here. It's not serving its purpose. And in many of us, when I say the church, I'm not speaking about Lakeside. Just so please don't get offended, or I'm speaking about the church. Many of us come to church and we're like this lamp. We just sit here, we look pretty, but we're not fulfilling God's purpose in our lives. Why? Because, and this is faith, I'm taking this in faith, this actually works. We're not plugged in to God's power. So now this lamp not only has a purpose, it not only looks pretty, it provides light. And what does light do? It distills the darkness. It distills the darkness. We're living in a world today that's dark. The internet is dark. Pornography, homosexuality, child molestation, you name it, it's dark. It's dark. Now, there are obviously good purposes in the internet that we can use, obviously, to reach the world, but it's dark. So each one of us has a purpose. God has created us. He saved us. And if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, he filled you to fulfill a purpose in the body of Christ, in this church, wherever you go. There, we need to be plugged in. The Word of God says in Matthew 5:14 says, we are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. I love going through on our way to Atlanta, or back from Atlanta, we go through Chattanooga, very beautiful city. And I love to watch the houses up on the hill. When we come through there late at night or during twilight, you see the houses on the hill. They're beautiful. They're large. They're mansions up on the hill. They can't be hidden. They're up on that hill, and their lights are on, and you can see them for miles, literally miles. A house. Set on a hill, cannot be hidden. We are God's light. God has set us apart. He set us apart to be the light in the world. Amen? Amen. So my first point is we need to be plugged in to the power of prayer. Three P's. My first P is prayer. The power of prayer. Jesus prayed. His apostles saw the power of prayer in Jesus, so they said, Jesus, teach us how to pray. And he took the time out of his schedule. He took the time to teach them how to pray. Now, the Lord's Prayer is just a guide that we should use to pray. It's not necessarily a prayer. It is a prayer, but it's more of an example on how to pray. So he taught them how to pray. Jesus prayed. Jesus got up at some nights, he just stayed up all night and he prayed. Why? Because he wanted to be plugged in to what God was doing in his life. So he prayed. How do we learn how to pray? How can we learn how to pray? Just pray. Paul says, when you come, I'll come before you, not with flowery words or, you know, elegant words. God's not looking for elegant words. The Word of God says, he knows your heart. You just come to him and say, Lord, here's the deal. Just talk to him. He's your father. Just like you speak to your earthly father, you speak to your heavenly father the same way. We pray, just talk to him. It's a conversation between you and God. Not necessarily a one-way conversation. You know, we need to stop and listen and meditate and hear what God is saying to us. But just pray. Just pray. And I feel as though one of the secrets to the power of God is prayer. The secret to the power of God is prayer. Because that's why the devil fights so hard to get us not to pray. He hates when we pray. He hated when Jesus prayed. He hates when we pray. Because when we pray, we receive power. We receive power through our prayer. We go to God and God says, yes, here's my child. Yes, here's my daughter. Here's my son. And we pray, he answers our prayer. He knows our needs. He answers our prayer. So we need to pray. We need to pray for our children. We need to pray for our families. We need to pray for our communities. We need to pray for our leaders. We need to pray. There's so much that we can pray for. We should never, we will or may never run out of things to pray for. So power in prayer. Power in prayer. Thank you, Father. When we learn, I've got a note that says, when we learn to pray by asking God for the impossible and expecting that he will do it. Asking God for the impossible. And I think someone mentioned this, Pastor Ricardo mentioned this on Sunday, talking about the supernatural. You know, we use that word, the supernatural, but in God's eyes, it's natural. Right. Like Sid Roth says, it's natural to be supernatural. What God does, when God heals someone, when God, a miracle takes place, to God, that's natural. Because that's what he does. As a father, you give something to your child, it's natural. It's not, your kid doesn't say, oh, I've got a supernatural father. There's nothing natural about giving your child something, just like God. He feels the same way. So to us, it may be supernatural, but to God, it's natural. It is totally natural to love us, to heal us, to deliver us, to set us free. It says that we should expect God to respond in power. The early church had a spirit of expectancy. When we come to church on Sunday, when we come to church on Wednesday night, it's not just to, again, sit and look pretty, but to expect. If you're not filled with the Holy Spirit tonight, you should be expecting to be filled tonight. If you're not saved, as I look around the room, I think most of us are, but if you're not saved, you should be expecting God, Jesus, to save you tonight. We should come with a spirit of expectancy because God has promised us. If you need healing, expect it because God has promised it. Thousands of years ago, 2,000 years ago, he did what you needed. There's nothing else that he needs to do for us. Healing has already been spoken for. Salvation has already been spoken for. So again, that spirit of expectancy. Praise God. Through the word of God. In the word of God. Again, going back to Acts chapter 4, verse 31 says, and they prayed, and I love that verse, and they prayed, and the place where they met was shaken, and they were filled with the Spirit, and spoke the word of God boldly. And Peter, Brother Peter, you talk of passion. The next P is passion. We need to be plugged into God with passion. Peter was a man of passion. We see Peter throughout the scripture, his different, attitudes. And one day Jesus was commending him for what he said. You are the Son of God. Jesus said, right, Peter. Man hasn't told you that, but the Spirit of God has told you that. And then maybe a couple of hours later, or maybe a day later, Jesus is rebuking him because of what he said. So Peter had passion. Peter had passion. And again, he when he received the power of God, he spoke with boldness. Thousands were saved at his word because of the power of the Holy Spirit in him. One heart and one soul is unity. Jake talked about community. And again, you can't spell community without unity. There's got to be unity within the body of Christ. We've got to be of one heart. They were in one place, in one accord, when the Holy Spirit fell upon them. Another person of passion was Paul. Paul had passion to kill the Christians. He felt as though he was doing God's will. He felt as though that was his purpose in life, to kill the Christians. He went to the leaders and said, hey, give me letters to go and kill these Christians. So he did that with passion until he met the Savior on the road to Damascus. And his passion changed. His passion was no longer to kill the Christians, but to be a Christian. So the power of God gives us passion, but it changes our passion also. It changes our passion. And in keeping with the P's, people of passion, the pastors in this church, our pastor, and a lot of times we joke about him, about his passion, such a passionate man for the people of God. He loves us. He loves Lakeside. He loves his community. Dr. Norm and many others. I'm not going to call everyone because I'll probably forget someone. Dr. Robinson. People of passion in this church that love Israel, that love their community, that love their church. That passion comes from the power of God. Jake talked about love, and it goes into passion. And I'm not going to, he talked very, almost like you're reading my notes, talked about love. We need to be plugged in to the power of love. Not just love that talks, you know, I love you. I tell my wife, I love you. Just like Jake tells his wife, he loves her. I love you. But we use that word so frivolously. It's like but the love of God, when the power of God comes in us, that love is genuine. Like you said, that love is sincere. It's a sincere love. We love each other. We love the church. These believers of this day, they sold their possessions. They sold their possessions. Barnabas and these guys, some of the example, they sold their possessions and gave to those that were in need. They looked out for those that were in need. The poor, the widows, the orphans. That's what the Word of God says, talks about righteousness. Taking care of the poor, taking care of the orphans, taking care of the widows. They loved their community. They loved each other. Finally, the third P is the power of proclamation. Like Jake talked about, the power of God was in them. They proclaimed the gospel. They proclaimed the good news. If we love God, we should proclaim the good news wherever we go. In our workplace, at Walmart, at Target, in our schools, young people, we should proclaim the love of God through that love of passion. We do that every Sunday. We proclaim, we announce, we declare God's goodness in our lives, in our community. We're not just saying those words because they sound good, they already do. We're saying those things because those are things that we want to see. Part of your earlier says, we speak those things that be not as though they were. That's faith. The power of God gives us faith to say that. The power of proclamation. Great power rested upon the apostles. Their preaching and their witnessing was effective because Jake used this word, God empowered them, empowered their teaching with the word of God. And he blessed the proclamation of the word. When they spoke the word, it was blessed. As we talked about earlier, thousands were saved. 5,000 in one occasion. 3,000 in one occasion. Those are just some examples. And again, the word of God says the church was added to daily because of the proclamation of the gospel by the early church, by the apostles. It says, we have been sent out to preach that message every day to sinners in our workplace. Anyway, I have several coworkers that I speak to, talk to about, you know, the goodness of God. And fortunately, I have, there are two or three of us in my section that are Christians, and we get together sometimes and we openly talk about, you know, the goodness of God so that the others that aren't saved can hear of God's faithfulness in our lives. We're proclaiming God's goodness openly to them. Acts 1:8, but you will receive power. So Jesus, like Jake's talking about, Jesus left, went away, but he says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. This is where they hung out. This is their main, this is where they lived, in Judea, which was a little further away, and then Samaria, which was a little further away, and then where else? To the ends of the world. Now, we physically can't go, most of us can't go, but we can do that through our missionaries. They've been sent. We support missionaries. So they go. But we can, our Jerusalem is Elizabethtown. My Jerusalem is Radcliffe. My Jerusalem is Fort Knox. Your Jerusalem is wherever you work. Okay? You don't have to go to Samaria. Now, if God calls you to Judea or Samaria or to Louisville or to Lexington or where else, that's great. God is using you. You're God's light in that area. But this is our Jerusalem. So let's get Jerusalem saved. Let's get Jerusalem delivered. Let's get Jerusalem saved and filled with the Holy Spirit and on fire for God. Then maybe we can move on to Judea. But I'll tell you what, more people are going to move into Jerusalem. So we've got to start all over again. So we may never leave Jerusalem. We may never leave Elizabethtown. But the point is, we use the power of God to proclaim the message, to proclaim the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So, you know, in conclusion, I wrote, we have many advantages over the early church, but I believe they were more empowered than the church of today, and despite of their limited resources, they accomplished more. Why? Because they were on fire for God. They saw miracles. They saw the work of Jesus. They experienced it. Now, today's our church, we don't see it. We're not seeing the blind healed. We're not seeing the leprosy being healed. We're not seeing the dead raised. It's happening. It's happened. Trust me. It's happening. And you listen to testimonies from guys like Reinhard Bonnke and these evangelists that are going into Africa and these remote, where people are not, they don't have the advantages that we have, just like the early church. Many of them don't have the internet. So what they receive is the word of God. They have nothing to judge about. They have no theology to well, you know, this, I was a Baptist, but now I'm a whatever. And they don't have that. They just, the word of God is spoken. Jesus healed you over 2,000 years ago. They believe it, they receive it. There's no wavering. The Word of God says, you know, we waver. Our faith wavers. They don't waver. The apostles back in the early church, they didn't waver. So they accomplished more. Why? They stuck to the basics. Like, I think Pastor and I were talking about last Wednesday, about basic training. You never forget basics, the basic training. Your son was in boot camp. You'll never forget boot camp. If you're in the military, you'll never forget boot camp. You'll never forget basic training because you learned the basics. You learn how to aim your weapon. You learn how to march. You learn how to wear your uniform. And you always go back to the basics. The Word of God is basic. There's nothing complicated about the Word of God. But they return to the basics, and God bless them, working through them in miraculous ways. We need to be plugged into the power of God, the power of passion, the power of prayer, the power of proclamation. So like I said, my testimony is in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We were in Germany, and I believe my wife had received the baptism earlier. She was at home in the quiet of her bedroom, and I became very jealous. I mean, it's a righteous jealousy. And I said, "Wow, I need to get filled." I saw the difference in her. I mean, speaking in tongues and like, wow, this is powerful. This is so cool. So I coveted, like Paul said, to covet those gifts. I coveted the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And so we were at Assemblies of God convention in Germany, and the superintendent was there and all these guys, and I said, tonight's my night. I expected it. I went forward, and you know, the rest is history. I expected it that night. And I was so excited. I still am. Maybe not as much as I was back then. I will be. But I was excited. I was speaking in tongues. I was laying in bed and praying in the Spirit just because I could. It was like so cool. I could pray in tongues. You know, so I did it. But you can be the same way tonight. If you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, first of all, if you're not saved, please, young people, if you can't remember the day that you gave your life to Christ, today's your day. Today's your day. Today, the Word of God says, today is the day of salvation. Today is your day to get plugged in to the purposes of God. That you can be that light in your school. You can be that light wherever you go. You are the light of the world. So tonight, real quick, we're not gonna be labeled. As a matter of fact, man, Matthew, I'm gonna have him play a song. So because I want you to minister at the altar tonight. So if you can just play that song quietly for us. So quickly, the invitation is for salvation. If you've never been saved, or you have been saved, and you want to rededicate your life to Christ, you want to let your light shine. I think of this song as a young child in the Assemblies of God Church. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Hide it under a bushel? No. I'm going to let it shine. Wherever I go, I'm going to let it shine. So tonight, real quick, I'm going to count to three. Nothing magical about three, but we're not going to continue to. So one, if you're not saved, we're not going to close our eyes. We're not going to bow our head because Jesus died for us openly. He didn't say, hey, close your eyes. I'm going to die for you. No one looked. They all looked. All eyes. It was on a hill. They all saw him die. They all saw him bleed and die for us. So we're not going to close our eyes. We're not going to bow our heads. So if that's you tonight, If you need to be saved, if you need to rededicate your lives to Christ, come quickly. Two, quickly, quickly, quickly. Anyone, anyone, anyone. Don't be ashamed. Jesus was not ashamed of you. He was not ashamed to die for you. Quickly. Three. No one? No one? Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. We thank you that we're all saved. We're all light in this world. God, and we thank you that we are serving the purpose that you have called us to do, Father God. We're walking in your will. We're walking in your purpose. We're walking in your plans for us, Father God. That we will be a light in the world that we live in, Father God, in our community, in our schools, on our jobs, wherever we go, Father God. In Jesus' precious name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So this is a Holy Ghost conference. So here's I really feel led to do this. Unless Dr. Norm overrides me. If you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, please come forward. If you're not filled and you desire to be filled, this is not we're not going to force anyone. But again, the power of God is available to us tonight to change our lives, to revolutionize our lives, just like it did with the early church. You know, we look at the life of Peter. What a transformation that was in Peter's life. The life of Paul, what a transformation. The guy went from a murderer to a savior. Well, not the savior, but a savior. An avenue for people to be saved through the power of God. That same power is available to you tonight. So if that's you, can we all stand? So if that's you tonight, if you desire to be filled with the Holy Spirit, please come forward. So next, our ministers, Matthew and Keely, if you would come. Those are our ministers. Pray. And I tell you, it's quick. It's not going to take, you know, there's no special words you have to say. The Spirit of God is so gentle. He's a gentleman. So, Father God, we expect the mighty move of your Spirit tonight. In this place. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
We want to minister. Baptism of the Holy Spirit or healing. Just let us know. You want healing. Come. Amen. Anybody else? Restoration.
No point of reference. You spoke to the dark and fleshed out the
I only want one person. You're ministering? Or you're healing. Oh, okay. Okay. Good. What's Amen. The baptism of the Holy Spirit and healing. Healing. Now listen, when he ministers, you just give him distance. I don't want people congregating. Just give him distance. Let him minister. Okay? You just stand. You know, if he falls out, you help, but let him minister one-on-one. Anybody else? Healing? Deliverance? You're struggling with habits? Thoughts? Suicidal thoughts? All those things? Come. We want to break it off you. Hallelujah. I want it one-on-one. So if you're a minister, you come. I want one-on-one. I don't want people congregating. The Lord told me that doesn't work. Amen. What's your problem? Huh? God of your Thank you, Jesus. No shatarabasidibosha. Amen. When they pray for you, if it's for healing and they pray for you, you have to exercise your faith, which means if it's in your back, move that back. Most of you just receive prayer and go. It's not going to happen that way. You have to exercise your faith. Amen. If it's plantar, I think they said it was plantar, whatever, you put that foot on the ground. In the name of, let the anointing of God work. That's how healing takes place. It's not going to take place by you just being prayed for. Learn to move. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. So when you minister to them, ask them to do something and check for the pain. That's what I'm trying to say. Jesus. Any other person sick? Come, let's minister to you. Hallelujah. Roto sararabasa. When we minister to you, you got to exercise your faith. Amen. Hallelujah. Look for the pain after we prayed for you. It's not going to come back. Don't listen to the devil.
Matchless in every way, wonderful, beautiful, glorious. Matchless in every way, wonderful, beautiful, glorious. Matchless in every way, wonderful, beautiful, glorious. Matchless in thank you.
Any other person, quickly. Brother, come. There's an assignment. Yes, come. There's an assignment the Lord has for you. Come closer. Don't be afraid. There's an assignment that the Lord has for you. And one of the reasons why the enemy has attacked you and has kept you in regrets and in your past, because he knows that when you get past your past, you will begin to live and begin to fulfill God's cause. Do you understand? You begin to live and begin to fulfill God's cause. Don't think your life is over. And don't think time has run out. And God is telling me to tell you that the days that are ahead of you are greater than anything that you've been through. Are you hearing me? Don't live in regret. People who live looking back never live for the present. And never fulfill the future. So the Spirit of God is telling me. You have to get out of the past. Don't spend most of your day regretting what you didn't do or what you have not done. Let it go. You hearing me? Now lift up your hands. Lift up your hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. From the crown of his head to the soles of his feet, I pray.
At your door.
Let
him in.
Thank you, Jesus.
See his glorious face.
Glory. Hallelujah.
He longs to be with you.
Glory. You're not going to recognize him anymore.
What have you
got? And the Bible says, and the Spirit of the Lord shall come upon thee. He says, and thou shalt be turned into another man.
Let him in.
Amen. Any other person?
And you'll be free.
Sickness. Depression. Anxiety. It has to go in this atmosphere. Are you hearing me? Don't take it home. Has to go. It 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 has to go.
Make us your dwelling.
It has to go.
Place.
Jesus. Jesus.
Make us your dwelling place.
It has to go. It has to go.
We open our hearts to you. Come in. Make yourself.
Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for your presence.
Make us your dwelling place.
Thank you.
Make us your dwelling place. Make us your dwelling place. Make us your dwelling place. We open our hearts to you.
I want to pray for a set of people that are here. You have a gift of dreams. You're strong in the dream dimension. I want to pray with you. Quickly, just come. Dreams. There's something God wants to release on you this evening by the Holy Ghost. Dreams. God dreams is strong on you. I want you to come. There's something God is going to unlock in your life tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Quickly, quickly. Sweet Holy Spirit of God. Just lift up your hands. Lift up your hands. And as I begin to pray, something is going to come on you tonight. By the Spirit of God, something is coming on you tonight. And when you leave this place, some of you are going to be translated. Some of you will be taken beyond this world into the heavens to experience and to see the future and to see. Your dreams are going to begin to change. They're going to become more intense, more accurate, more prophetic. Are you ready? Are you ready? Jesus. That's it. Receive. That's it. That's the Spirit of God. He's just moving over you now. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. Receive. That's it. La tocara de beso darabas. Revedeso darabas. Receive. Receive. That's it. Receive. Kate socatera desto tarahandes. Re beres. Receive. That's it. That's it. Mante de bose da de banda de boshana na mande de boshana na mandas. Rebede che sunare de bohosta na nemos. Repetere de bosi kana na bahaste de bosh. Repetere de bakaste de boshata na ma. Bo anzi karistar es dugare de. Repetere sure de kastra enzis. Shitere estore des. Le perene soga enteremento ne menze dele betes perantos peredes tondarara hasteres. So I speak to that gift. I speak to it now to come alive. Ma karaba se karaba. Every finger of darkness that has fought against that which God has planted in her, after tonight, clarity comes. Holy Spirit of God. Yes. Yes. Touch her tonight. We unlock. We unlock it. That's the power of God. Receive it. That's the power of God. That's it. Receive. Receive. That's it. Thank you, Jesus. 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 As I lay my hands on you, I just already begin to see your kids. And your children, I just see them in the spirit that what God is on you, what is on you is on your children too. You're laughing. I just laid my hands on you. I just saw it. It's on your children. So that's why your children are able to pick up things in the spirit. Where are they? The twins. Bring them. Let me pray with all of you. I want to pray for all of you. Dear Jesus, dreams and visions, no regrets. No fears, no regrets, no fears, no compromise. That's it. Father, let it soak her. Every fear that has shut down the gift of God. Boldness, 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 boldness. You're scared. You don't have to be scared. See this one? This one has a prophetic, a very strong prophetic gift is on her. Hallelujah. You're scared. It's okay. Thank you, Jesus. Precious Father. Oh, dear Jesus. Dear Jesus. Let me minister to her. Come. Lift up your hands. Thank you, Father. That after tonight, ba so he me te lebetosa prehede sotra ra. She begin to see into the heavens. Let her begin to see into the heavens. In the name of Jesus. 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 See, the power of God is not for some people. All it takes is an openness. It takes when people are open and hungry. See, I was 16 years old when God's power touched my life. It has nothing to do with church. It has nothing to do with even being the daughter of a pastor. It has to do with being hungry. Are you hungry enough? Are you hungry enough to say, Lord, I want to make a difference. I don't just want to be like the crowd. See, the greatest temptation as a daughter of a pastor, I'm speaking to you, is to struggle to fit into the crowd and to despise the lineage that God has put you into. But when you recognize, I'm speaking into your future, when you recognize that what God has for you is greater than those things you're looking at, your friends and all those people that are fooling around, when you realize that what God has for you is greater than all that you see around you, then it will explode on the inside of you. You hear what I'm saying? Don't try and be like them. You don't have to. Your lineage is greater. It's greater. Hallelujah. Don't give in to the pressure. Thank you, Jesus. It's every night that the anointing increases, the glory gets heavier. So I said, when you start, you can't switch it off. You can't switch it off. Father, I ask you that you begin to touch our children. Father, give them a hunger for you. Are you running? I'm not coming to pray for you. Don't run away. Give them a hunger for you. Dear Jesus, give us a hunger for you. Give us a hunger for you. Give us a hunger for you. The Lord has told me to tell you that you have just taken a step of faith. You've just taken a step of faith, which is a very small thing, but there is so much more that He has, so much greater that He's going to do through you that the mind cannot imagine. Are you hearing me? When I'm speaking, I'm not just speaking in terms of your teaching gift. I'm talking about in terms of the grace of God in the scientific area that He has placed on your life. Because He is going to connect you in such a way that you cannot imagine. So what you need to do is do what you need to do. You understand what I say? You need to do what you need to do. Get all the paperwork and all that stuff, which is just a backup. But it's time. And it's close. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We begin to ask you, Lord, that you will so soak our lives. I want to pray for you again. Yes, yes. The Bible says that as David began to play on the harp, the Bible says that the demons that troubled Saul could not stay. They could not stay. Lord, help us to take the music ministry to the next level. Lift up your hands. it'll play. And demons will not be able to stay, will not be able to stay, will not be able to stay. That's the power of the Holy Ghost. Will not be able to stay. Will not be able to stay. Because as you begin to play, you know, we always say, Pastor, that the Spirit filled the place. Yes, the Spirit filled the place. But the sound first filled the place. That's why music ushers in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Music ushers in the presence of the Holy Spirit. When the music is right. So that's why I asked them to change that to rock music they were playing. The Spirit of God does not move in that kind of atmosphere. Sometimes it excites us, but it doesn't move the Spirit. You need the right music. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise. We give you praise. That's it. We worship you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to round up. I want to encourage us tomorrow. We're going to be talking about the glorious church. And the glory of God is going to hit this place. And on Sunday, it's going to be greater. So I want you to come hungry. Come thirsty. Come open. Whatever your destiny. I believe God has destinies in this place. We have a destiny together and we have destinies individually. It's time to upgrade. You understand? Increase the frequency. Increase the power. So that as we minister, we're going to change the community. Amen. We're going to take what God is giving us and God is doing in us and through us to our dying world. I think that's where the church has stopped out. Because we receive, we receive, we receive, but we never release what He's given us. As we begin to release it, then there will be an increase. As you begin to release it, there's an increase. As you release, there's an increase. As you give out, God gives you more. So if you despise what God has given you, He can't give you more. If you despise what God has given you, He can't give you more. Hallelujah. Amen. I want to call on the pastor to pray and round us up. Glory to His name. Amen. Let's put our hands together for Minister Sydney. Such an awesome message. Amen. We love you so much. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Tomorrow, if you need a healing, once the conference is concluded, I have a water basin, about 25, 30 towels. And I believe that as I humble myself and wash your feet, God will help heal you and He will also heal me. I've been diagnosed, to my surprise, with a hernia. I thought it was a strain. And I don't want it. So I'm just going to receive my healing as I'm believing for yours. And the Holy Spirit just spoke to my wife and said that an act of humility like that can bring your healing. So if you need healing, come back tomorrow. Come back tomorrow. If you received healing today, praise God. But come back tomorrow. And I believe that act of humility, I believe we're going to see some miracles tomorrow. If you know somebody that needs healing, invite them tomorrow. I don't even care what condition their feet are in. I'm committed. Dr. Norm's committed to help me. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. Hallelujah. God bless you, keep you, cause His face shine upon you, lift up your countenance upon you, give you peace. Be ready. God woke me up at 5:15 last night and gave me a revelation. I'm still working on it. It's not ready to be revealed yet, but I'm telling you what. God has not forsaken you, no matter where you are. Just know that. Hallelujah. God is not sorry that He called you, even though He made mistakes. Or I'm sorry, even though you made mistakes. God is not sorry He called you. Yeah, laugh it up, people. Go ahead. Praise God. He doesn't make mistakes, but we do. Hallelujah. See you tomorrow.